So, okay, thank you very much, everybody, for being here. So that's so that looks like a very exciting program, and so I hope that during the evening session we will be able to do some good stuff. So the title of this series of lecture is Analytic Theory of Trace Functions. Maybe also it could be dubbed could be called Applied Eladic Cohomology. And I am sure that people with would see the term applied close to the term Eladic Cohomology would see this as a profanity, but anyway. And so what I really want to explain is this trace function which coming from Eladic Cohomology and which are usually objects which are very complicated to get your hands on because the amount of material you have to learn before getting to the definition or the construction of trace function is huge. And what I want to explain is what you can do when you have them, and especially thanks to Deligne and other people like Katz and Lomont, who have proved so many great theorems about them, how you could use them to do very applied things, but then prove, interesting theorem, especially in analytic number theory. So maybe I will just start. So what are we very interested in number theory? So we are interested in understanding analytic properties or analytic structures of sets of integers or subset thereof. And when studying these objects, we are especially interested in understanding congruence classes. So you have some modulus Q greater than one, and you want to understand this the congruence class. So A mod Q, and this notation goes back to Gauss. So, and for instance, you want to be able to understand the intersection of this congruence class with other subsets of the integers. So the obvious subset is for instance, the set of primes. And so then in the set of you know very well in the case of primes, if and only if A is coprime with Q, then you have that this intersection is infinite, and so this is due to this is Dirichlet prime number theorem, and you have even a more precise version besides infiniteness. You have a more precise version which is really Dirichlet prime number theorem, and so in modern or in pedantic term, it could be called the Sato-Tate law for cyclotomic fields, or the Chebotarev density theorem for cyclotomic fields. So in analytic number theory, we are really looking after maybe much more elementary problem than Sato-Tate laws. But nevertheless, we face the question of understanding congruences, and then if you want to understand congruences, naturally, this leads you to the functions on the space of congruences, which is Z mod Q. Okay, and So when you want to understand that Z mod Q, then you have some reduction, which is the Chinese remainder theorem, which reduces you to the case where Q is a prime power. And then you have the really, what is usually the most interesting case is when Q is a prime. And then Z mod Q is a field, noted FQ. So trace functions are special cases of function on the finite field FQ. So trace functions. Are functions on FQ that come up quite naturally. So when doing analytic number theory. So, and then what, and then what I want to explain is how they come in and how their knowledge allows you to work in analytic number theory. So, examples of trace functions. So, then you have the very first example, which is Legendre symbol. So, which is plus one if A mod Q is a square and coprime with Q, minus one if A mod Q is a non-square, and zero if A is zero mod Q. So, and this Legendre symbol, it's multiplicative, and it's a special case of so-called Dirichlet character, for which, so you don't need it to be prime, so for the Legendre symbol, you essentially need it to be prime, so Dirichlet characters, so invented by Dirichlet, so the homomorphism of the multiplicative group. So the group homomorphism of this abelian group, the multiplicative group of Z mod Q. And, which were introduced first by Dirichlet to prove his prime number theorem. And okay, let me say extended by zero to F, so to Z mod Q. So first, okay. Another important class of examples are the additive characters. So which are the function, so which are so Dirichlet character, I will write it with a chi, and an additive character, I will write it with a psi. And so, for instance, an additive character is always of the form EQ of X, where EQ X is the exponential okay. Yeah, sorry. Okay, and you see, with these two classes of functions, then you have so these two classes of functions satisfies orthogonality relation. So well known, but so I write them because I will. So you have one for the additive characters. So if you have two additive characters and you average their product over the full finite field, so then you know that you get the Dirac function. And similarly for Dirichlet characters, so you have this relation. Okay. So you can also combine so other examples of trace functions are products of chi and psi. So these are other examples, and you have also a trace function which is formed by averaging the product, so then you have the Gauss sums. We'll take this one. So I take this additive character EQ, which is written over that board, and then I multiply it by any Dirichlet character, and I form the average, and I normalize this average by divided by 1 over square root of Q. And so, in fact, here you get this Gauss sum, which is a trace function, but it's not really new because, of course, you know that the Gauss sum at A is chi minus 1 of A, or chi bar of A, evaluated at 1. So it's a multiple of Dirichlet character, and in fact, G chi of 1 is 1, so let's say if chi is not the trivial character. Okay. So, but you have, of course, much more elaborate trace functions which are coming up. And so, from where could they arrive? So, then you have the example of algebraic exponential sums. And so, for instance, suppose you want to study the solution of a polynomial equation. So where all the entries are integers and the Q is a polynomial with integral coefficients. So if you want to study this equation, then it's natural to study the same equation, but modulo Q. So to study the values of this polynomial, which are in the zero congruence class. So at least it's a necessary step to just to say anything about this problem. At least you should be able to say something about this problem, because solution to this problem leads to solution to this problem by reduction modulo Q. And so you need to study this, and for instance, it may come from using the so-called circle method, from analytic number theory, or if you are more algebraist, you may want to look at some as a principle. Okay. And so, let's say when you do the circle method, so then you are faced with this sort of exponential sums. So these functions. I don't have an eraser. Excuse me. So, okay. So by the fifth lecture, it should be really perfect. So then you meet, when you do the circle method, you meet this kind of function. So you see what you have here, you have this trace function. So let's say you have a function y, you have your an entry over z mod q to the n, and then you evaluate this entry. So you evaluate it at q multiplied by a, and then you take this additive character. Okay, so it gives you another trace function. And then what you can do furthermore is that you can do the discrete Fourier transform in this, on that space of, on Z mod Q to the N. So on that space, you have this also additive character, EQ of x dot y, and you form this Fourier transform, and now I have put this normalization factor, which is analog of the normalization factor which occurs for the Gauss sum over there. So these really come up completely naturally. So Fourier transform of additive exponentials of values of polynomials. And it comes really when you start to study this polynomial equation over Z, and so either by the Hardy little wood circle method or by trying to use as a principle, you can get to these sorts of problems. Yeah, it's scalar product. Yeah. So these are vectors. Yeah. So stop me whenever something is not clear. Feel free, really. And so this, so you have a case where really the circle method and the ASA principle really match almost exactly is the case where Q is quadratic. Q is a quadratic form. And here I will take a quadratic form. So it's of interest in four variables. So a quaternary quadratic form. And on that occasion, so Clostermann in 1926 or so introduced a variant of the circle method. So he wanted to study the solution of this equation when Q is a quaternary quadratic form. And in fact, he wanted to prove the Hasse principle in that case, which was not known. So it was known only before in five variables. And so he introduced a variant of the circle method. And then he got a new type of trace function. He got these so-called Clostermann sums. And maybe they are so important that I should take a new paper for them. So these Clostermann sums, so which I will write KL of A at Q is 1 over square root of Q times the sum over X in FQ star of EQ. And where do I put my A? Yeah. A X minus 1 plus X. Oh, no, sorry. X minus 1 plus AX. Okay, so what is this thing? Is the Fourier transform of the function x goes to the additive character evaluated at the multiplicative inverse of x. Okay, so don't ask me why this is coming out. But so this is this variant. So in a sense, you see you. Here you don't exactly get a sum in four variables, so you get just a sum in just one variable. And so, what Clostermann was able to do is what Clostermann gave the first. Okay, he invented this sum, so it's no surprise, but he was the first non-trivial bound. these sums. So specifically, he proved that, so these are real numbers, but he proved that in absolute value, these Clostermann sums, they are bounded by 2 times q to the 1/4. Okay? And so now, look at this sum, the original Clostermann sum. You see, this sum, it's a sum of q minus 1 terms divided by square root of q. So the trivial bound for this sum is, let's say it's q to the one half, or more precisely, q minus 1 over q to the 1/2. So what Clostermann was able to do, he was able to improve this trivial bound, which you get simply by bounding each of these complex exponential by 1, this q minus 1 exponential you bounded by 1. So he saves a factor q to the 1/4 over the trivial bound. So what does it mean? It means that when x varies over the FQ star, the invertible congruence classes mod Q, this function oscillates a lot up to getting really that Q to the 1/4 cancellations. And it's a very neat computation using moments. And so the consequence of this, so it was very neat, is that so-called, or I will call it to make it short, the Hasse principle for quaternary quadratic forms. So what, what do I mean? So it's that given let's say D an integer, then the equation, so Q of x1, x2, x3, x4 equal D as a solution in Z4. Okay, it's not exactly an if and only if, but it's almost if and only if it has a solution in every Z mod Q to the 4. So if you can solve this equation modulo Q for every Q, then you can solve the solution in the integers. Okay, it's not exactly true because in fact, the D should be sufficiently large and maybe have a small congruence constraint with respect to the, for instance, if D is coprime with the discriminant of the quadratic form and is sufficiently large, it's okay. So this statement is not exactly accurate, but nevertheless, almost true. Okay, and so then you see this is one application, or when you have this sort of function which are formed out of, additive characters, summation, and algebraic manipulation on the variable, like taking the multiplicative inverse and adding A times x and evaluating an additive character and then summing, and then you want to get, for instance, to prove that this sum is small or smaller than a trivial estimate would give, then it has very interesting implications. Of course, so this derivation is not at all short. You have to set up the full variant of this Hardy Littlewood circle method. But this is part of I would say analytic number theory. Okay, are there any questions? No? Okay. Sorry. It would have been too easy, for me at least. So I will give another example which we'll see very often, which are the so-called hyper-Clusterman sums. And really, we will see them very, really often. So, for k greater than 2, so k of a mod q is, so you have again a normalizing factor, q over k minus 1 over 2. So you take k variable in this multiplicative group, and you impose an algebraic polynomial constraint that their product should be equal to A, and then you evaluate EQ of the sum. Okay, and you see for k equals 2, this is essentially the Clusterman sum by a change of variable. So you get back your Clusterman sum. And so in fact, what happens is that in the middle of the previous century, for k equals 2, so André Weil, so as a consequence of his proof of the Riemann hypothesis for curve, which eventually suggested him the full Weil conjectures, proved, in fact, that the Clusterman sums, KL2, AQ, so he improved on Clusterman, proved that it's not only bounded by 2 times q to the 1 quarter, but it's really bounded by 2. So, and again, what does it mean if you look at this? It means here you have a sum of essentially q terms, exactly q minus 1, and then you divide by, and then this sum of these q minus 1 terms, they prove that it's bounded by 2 square root of 2 instead of a trivial bound q minus 1. So he saved really an exponent q to the 1 half over the trivial bound. And in a sense, this is really the maximal consolation that you could get. So we will see this a bit later. And for a higher case, then you have a bound, but which lies much deeper, and you had to wait maybe 30 more years to get it, which is due to the line. And which is that also the Clusterman sums of higher rank, so to speak, higher dimension, they are bounded by, I guess, it's K in general. So, and here this is something which is even stronger, because here you have a sum, so here you have K variable. And your k variables are linked by a single polynomial equation. So you have, in effect, a sum about k minus one variable, and so the size of the sum is about q to the k minus one. So the number of terms is q to the k minus one, and then you divide by the square root of this number of terms, and what you get is that this sum is absolutely bounded. It's bounded only in terms of k, but independently of q. So what is important is that no q in the bound. So. Okay, and so this is due to De Ligne, to Pierre De Ligne, and it's a consequence of his proof of the Weyl conjectures. And maybe I should give an application of this, too, which are another example of Sato-Tate law. Example of Sato-Tate. So as you will see, this scientific program is very well done because you will see that the four courses have a lot of interaction and intersection. I hope not too much repetition, but so here is an example of Sato-Tate which follows from this. So Sato-Tate for Gauss sums. So in the beginning, in my example, I've introduced these normalized Gauss sums, G chi of 1, where chi varies over the characters of the multiplicative group of the finite fields FQ. So this is a set of q minus 1 complex number of modulus 1. Okay. And so the theorem is that as q goes to infinity, the set becomes equidistributed with respect to the R measure, so the circle measure on C1. And so what have the Clostermann sums to do with this? So the proof, so one has to show, it is sufficient to show, necessary and sufficient to show that for any k, in fact we could take it greater than 1, then 1 over q minus 1 sum over the characters of these Gauss sums. So you want to prove that the convergence of the various moments of Gauss sums, so and then you need to show that this converges to the integral over the circle of z to the k dz, and which is zero when k is greater than one. Okay, and so what you do is that it's an exercise: compute this sum which is here, and what you will see is that you will see the k-th hyper-Clostermann sums coming out, okay, and the De Ligne's bound here is more than sufficient to show that this average indeed converges to zero. Okay, so just to say, any question on this? Yeah.
What does that converges to mean? Like, are you, like, as Q grows?
Yeah, as Q, okay. So given a prime number Q, I take the set of all normalized Gauss sums. So these are complex numbers. Okay, maybe I should take Q different from 1, because then the corresponding Gauss sum is not on the unit circle, but it's only one point. I could even let it. And so then you have a set of Q points, or Q minus 2 points, which lies on the unit circle. Okay, and so what you want to show is that whether these points are uniformly distributed with respect to the R measure on the circle. So, but you have but in a given angular sector, the proportion of Gauss sums which go into that sector asymptotically is the size of the sector, is the value of the angle. Oh, so this is an exercise. So the exercise is, what I say is that consider the definition of these Gauss sums, take their k power, and then average over chi. And then what you will see is that you will see exactly the Clusterman, the hyperclusterman sums coming. So maybe I can just, you see, this, so it's also part of something Fourier theory. If you want to see this that way, you could do the computation. It's a very nice computation to do, and so you will see when you do this. Okay, you average over chi. You use the property of multiplicative characters. When you average m over, you get 0 or 1. And this sum here will get you, so when you write what is a Gauss sum and take the k power, then you will get k term, k variable, x1, xk, and when you average over chi, you get that the product of this variable has to be constant. So, yeah, exercise. Now, it's something very neat to do, and in fact, you don't even need the full force of the Lin theorem, so you could, so see what you need. It's, okay. Okay, so that's a very, and it's something very deep, so it could fit into the previous course, but it's over the finite fields. Another question about? So, yeah, so maybe what I should say here is that, again, to show this convergence, what you usually do is that you consider the characteristic here, you want to count the number of Gauss sums whose angle is in a given angular sector. And what you do is that you approximate the characteristic function of this angular sector in terms of exponentials. And then you are led to compute, to evaluate the Gauss sum along this exponential, so this z to the k function. Sorry? So there is one bound that you can get, is that you can fix in these k variables, you can fix k minus one variable or k minus two variable and reduce to a one dimensional Clusterman sum. So you could fix all variables but one. And, or, but two, I would say, here, in this presentation, and use a veil bound, for instance. This bound is the best possible. Before the line, I don't remember. So people did this, but I don't think anybody got anything beyond using veil bound in the trivial manner by fixing a few variables. I don't remember. Okay. Okay. Hyperclusterman sums. Yeah. Okay, so now I can explain what are trace functions. So these are examples, and now I will try to really give the structure or the constructions. So the first thing is to see that FQ is in fact is a set of FQ points of the affine line. So really trace functions are rather functions on this affine line, and in fact they are even or it's even better to see them in terms of the projective line over FQ. Okay. And so they are constructed out of constructible L-adic schemes. Okay, so what I am going to do is I fix L a prime number which is different from Q. I consider the field of L-adic numbers. Then I consider the closure of the L-adic number, and in fact, that's again the question. I'm because I want to do analytic number theory, I'm going to embed this this field or into the complex numbers. Okay, but for this, that's not so important at the moment. So now let K be the field of this curve. So which is just the field of rational fraction over FQ in one variable. Okay, and then this field is contained. So I pick a separable closure of that field. Okay. And I defined. Okay. GGOM to be the geometric Galois group and this geometric Galois group is contained into the arithmetic Galois group which is just the Galois group of the field. And so, in my definition, so you need a more specialized, more general definition, but for us, we will be happy with a very, very concrete definition. So for me, and so it's a bit largely false, but what I will call an L-adic sheaf is a continuous representation. Alors, so either I will so rho of the Galois group into V, where V is a QL bar vector space. Okay, among other things, I will require further properties. What else will I need for now? Okay, and so, So sometimes I will note my notation Sometimes it will be noted with an F. Sometimes it will be noted rho or rho of F. So yeah, 2 more minutes. Okay, good. Didn't I start at 9:45 or it's 45 minutes?
15 minutes.
Oh, sorry. Okay, okay. I will adjust next time. Okay, so what do I have with this representation? So this is a Galois representation. So rho is unramified outside finite set of points in P1 of FQ bar. Okay, so let's say, so which means that there exists U, an open set, so defined over FQ, such that for any, so non-empty open set, for any X U over FQ. So the inertia group which is a subgroup of the decomposition group at X which is contained into the Galois group into the geometric Galois group acts trivially on V. And so because it acts trivially, then you have a well-defined action of a Frobenius element at X, so okay, and then you define the trace function of rho or of F to be the function which to X in this open set associate the trace of this Frobenius element at X acting on this vector space. And so this is an Eladic number, and because you have chosen an embedding of your Eladic number into the complex number, then you create a complex valued function. And so all the functions that we have discussed so far, they come from this construction, so from a Galois representation of the field of the projective line, and then this Galois representation is almost everywhere unramified, and whenever it's unramified, you have a Frobenius conjugacy class with a well-defined at least trace, and then you can compute the trace, and it gives you a function. So, okay. So what we will do next time is we will play a bit with this concept, explain how out of these trace function one can build new ones. just by the simple due to the representation theoretic form of these trace functions. So one can take products by taking tensor products, dual, and so on. And then we will see how to use so the main theorem of Deligne on Eladic cohomology to do analytic number theory with trace functions. Okay, thank you. So.
Any questions for Philippe?
Is there any reason we are focusing on just on P1? So for example, like in the hypercustom in some case, it seems like Pn minus 1 is more natural.
This hypercluster and sums, they are really living on P1. So, but you have more let me show you where is my, are there somewhere? Yeah. So I have my parameter A. What am I doing? No. Okay. Sorry. I have this parameter A, and what I consider is consider the sum over, of course, I have all these variables which are in the multiplicative group, this K variable, but what I require is that their product be equal to A, so I sum over all solutions of this equation. So here I am on P1. I have, of course, these hyperclusterman sums, they are constructed by a push-forward map from a product of k multiplicative groups to a single multiplicative group. But the object itself is on P1. But there may be more general hyperclusterman sums. So if you do automorphic form or geometric Langlands program, you have Clusterman sums who live on higher dimensional spaces, also naturally. Yeah. But these are the ones which come for us in analytic number theory because we are interested in a propriety of function living on Z, on the integers. So, yeah. Why you get...
Also, I guess the sort of k equals to 2 case follows from Deligne's work. So can you derive the fact that the hyperclustermin sum is a trace function from that?
I'm not going to explain how you build hyperclustermin sums as trace function. So there is mechanism, and this one is rather deep, because... I am going to speak on trace function only on the affine line or the projective line, but to construct the hyperclusterman sums, you need to introduce the concept of sheaf over higher dimensional varieties.
Somehow you construct some higher dimensional varieties and then you push,
to P1. Exactly.
Just one exercise. So that step of, So the fact that you can actually construct this higher dimensional stuff and then push back to get Clusterman sum, hyperclusterman sum, is not a trivial fact, I guess.
No, not at all. And in fact, I will hide a lot of things into a black box. So I will tell you this is a trace function, this is a trace function. I will give you a few recipes to build all trace functions from new one. I will not discuss the ones which are formed. So I will discuss examples of trace functions which are created by push forward. But the geometric analysis beyond the proof that these objects are trace functions, I will not do. I'm interested in applications in this course.
So let's save any additional questions for the coffee break. We'll resume again at 11:30. So thank you, Philippe.